Hey there, Prayesh.
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांध्यस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामयं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरुं श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगण ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिकाकान्ता राधाकान्ता नमोऽस्तु ते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे।
So, Hare Krishna, accept my obeisances, all glories to Prabhupada. Thank you very much for inviting us to your wonderful program.
Thank you, Prabhu.
So, anybody have any questions or?
Yes, Prabhu. We were continuing with the last three questions that was announced. The first question we had was like in the last week session was.
What was the question?
So last week you answered one question, but because we ran out of time, we need to go ahead with the second question now. I'm just scrolling. So why is chanting Hare Krishna mantra the only method recommended for Kali Yuga? What about other methods?
What about other methods, huh? So it's explained. That in this Kali Yuga, there's only one way to achieve success.
Okay, so for spiritual progress in this age of Kali, there is no alternative. There is no alternative. There is no alternative to the holy name, the holy name, the holy name of the Lord. For progress in spiritual life, the sutras recommend meditation in Satya Yoga, sacrifice for the satisfaction of Lord Vishnu. In Treta Yuga, the gorgeous and gorgeous worship of the Lord in the temple and in Devapara Yoga. But in the age of Kali, one can achieve spiritual progress only by chanting the holy name of the Lord. This is confirmed in various scriptures. In Srimad Bhagavatam, there was many references to this fact. in the 12th canto, 3.51, it said, do you want to read that for me?
Kaler dosha nidera janastireko mahagunan kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sangha param rajet.
In the age of Kali, there are many faults, for people are subjected to many miserable conditions. Yet in this age, there is one great benediction. Simply by chanting Hare Krishna mantra, one can freed from all material contamination and thus be elevated to the spiritual world. Narada Panakaratara.
Narada Pancharatra.
Also praises the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra as follows.
Trayo Veda Shat Angan.
It's okay, you can read the...
Okay. The essence of all Vedic knowledge, comprehending the three kinds of Vedic activity, Karmakanda, Janakanda, and Upanishad Kanda, the chandas, or the Vedic hymns, and the processes for satisfying the demigods is included in the eight syllables Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. This is the reality of all Vedanta. The chanting of the holy name is the only means to cross the ocean of nescience. Similarly, Kali Sanatara Upanishad states, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. These 16 names composed of 32 syllables are the only means to counteract the evil conflicts of Kali Yuga. In all the Vedas, it is seen that to cross the ocean of nescience, there is no alternative to the chanting of the holy name. Similarly, Sri
Madhvacharya,
while commenting upon the
Manduka Upanishad,
has quoted the following verse from.
Okay, just read the translation.
Okay. In Dvaita Para Yoga, one could satisfy Krishna and Vishnu only by worshiping him gorgeously according to the Pandavakaris. But in the age of Kali, one can satisfy and worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, simply by chanting his holy name. In his Bhakti Sandarbha,
Srila Jiva Goswami
strongly emphasizes chanting the holy name of the Lord as follows. Sri Jiva Goswami states that the substance of all Vedic mantras is the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. Every mantra begins with the prefix Nama Om, and eventually addresses by the name of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By the supreme will of the Lord, there is a specific potency in each and every mantra chanted by the great sages like Narada Muni and other Sris. Chanting the holy name of the Lord immediately renovates the transcendental relationship of the living being with the Supreme Lord. To chant the holy name of the Lord, one need not depend upon other paraphernalia, for one can immediately get all the desired results of linking with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It may therefore be questioned why there is a necessity for initiation or further spiritual activities and devotional service for one who engages in chanting of the holy name of the Lord. The answer is that although it is correct that one who fully engages in chanting the holy name need not depend upon the process of initiation, generally a devotee is addicted to many abominable material habits due to material contamination from his previous life. In order to get quick relief from all these contaminations, it is required that one engage in the worship of the Lord in the temple. The worship of the deity in the temple is essential to reduce one's restlessness due to the contaminations of conditioned life. Thus, Narada and his
Pancharatra Trikis Vidhi
and other great sages have sometimes stressed that since every conditioned soul has a bodily concept of life aimed at the sense of enjoyment, to restrict this sense of enjoyment, the rules and regulations for worshiping the deity in the temple are essential. Sri Rupa Goswami has described that the holy name of the Lord can be initiated,
can be chanted by liberated soul.
Oh, thank you. Can be chanted by liberated souls, but almost all the souls we have to initiate our condition. It is advised that one chant the holy name of the Lord without offenses and according to the regulative principles. Yet due to their past bad habits, they violate these rules and regulations. Thus the regulative rules for worship of the deity are also simultaneously essential.
So you can see from this verse how the chanting of Hare Krishna is stressed, you know.
Yes.
Because in Kali Yuga, to chant, of course, there are many mantras, there are so many mantras, but this Hare Krishna mantra is Maha Mantra, you know. That is only addressed as Maha Mantra, that means the topmost mantra. And a mantra must be suitable for the age, you know. You know, in Kali Yuga, in Dwapara, in Satya Yuga, they chant the mantra Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So, millions of years ago, you know.
Okay, I was going to say, when did that end?
Satya Yuga, Dwapara Yuga.
There are four yugas, and in Satya Yuga, that golden age, it was, it lasts for about 1.7828 million, something like that. Then you have the next yuga, you can see here. The next yuga is Treta Yuga. You can see here, worship of the Lord in the temple is stressed. And then you have the age prior to this, Dwapara Yuga. And then after that, we have this age of Kali, you know. So it is like a calendar month. It just grows, you know. Kali Yuga lasts for 432,000 years. Dwapara Yuga lasts about 800 and double that amount. No? And then Treta Yuga is about 1.28 million. And then you have this golden age, Satya Yuga, lasts about 1.728 million years, about that. So if you take this, they could rotate like a calendar month, you know. So right now we are now in the period of Iron Age of Quarrel. It's called the Kali. Quarrel always. Everybody is quarreling and fighting, you know. So in this age, the method of perfecting one spiritually is by, he says here in this verse just now we read. See? This age, there's so many miserable conditions, but simply by chanting Hare Krishna mantra, one can be free from all material contamination and thus be elevated to the spiritual world. So this is the recommended, just like if you go to a medical shop, the pharmacy, you'll find there's so many kinds of medicine there, you know. You can't just pick whatever medicine you like. It has to be under prescription. So the medicine that is prescribed for this age is to chant this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And this is why this Hare Krishna Mantra, because it's specifically given by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is God himself who came 500 years ago, and he introduced this chanting of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So why we chant this mantra? Because it's given by God. And it's sense. Also
what? When it talks about the syllables, this talking about the syllables of God, that's a language that we don't really speak to each other down here, but God picks up real well. And if he told us to talk to him like that himself, then we should be doing that.
So when you chant this mantra, Hare Krishna, you're actually talking with God, you know?
Yes.
So I'm sure you have tried chanting. It must be very pleasing to your mind, yes?
Yes.
Although it's very strange to you, but by chanting, the mantra is making you happy because, as you said just now, it's the language of God, you know?
Yes. Yes. So no, I could feel it change my entire vibration from being hectic to very calm or very worried or thinking about a lot of stuff to not having any thought and just being present.
Yes, it says here in this verse, it destroys all kind of problems, you know. So in this verse it says, when you chant Hare Krishna, it says, I'm offering my respectful obeisance to Supreme Lord Hari, the congregational chanting, you see that, who destroys all sinful reaction, you see that? So when you are free from all kind of sinful reaction, karma, as we say, then you become happy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Yes.
And it relieves, and by offering obeisances, one get relief from all material suffering. So that's why the name of God is so powerful. Only God's name can actually relieve us from all these material problems, you know?
Yes.
There's nothing else that can actually help us except for the name of God.
Yes.
The name of God is so powerful that even if you chant, you know, it says here.
Even in other religions, in Christianity, they have removed the name of God from the Bible because it being such a powerful name. And so it was removed and then it was broken into syllables. And it was told to me when I was very young that you only use the name of God when you really, really need it. And it was something weird that why they would teach that to us blew my mind, you know, because
really?
You need God every day. Yeah, when I was a little kid in Catholic school, they said you don't ever say the name, and they told us the name Yahweh, and then as an adult, as a Christian, I learned that it was not Yahweh, but it was Jehovah, and then when I learned more about God himself and learned more about Sanskrit, I learned that that wasn't even accurate, that's English, that's not his name at all, you know, and so then I learned more about the Vedic culture, and then now this is where I'm at.
Wow.
So the thing is that if you chant the right name, then you see this verse here.
Mm-hmm.
Can you read this?
Simply by chanting.
Yeah, go ahead.
Simply by chanting one holy name of Hari, a sinful man can counteract the reaction to more sins than he is able to commit.
See that?
Brahma, the Vishnu Purana.
So when you chant the name of God, then you should be able to become free from all kind of sinful activities that you have done in so many lifetimes. You understand? It says further here. Can you read this also?
If one chants the holy name of the Lord, even in a helpless condition or without desiring to do so, all the reactions of a sinful life depart. Just as when a lion roars, all the small animals flee in fear. Garuda Purana.
So you see, that means the power of God's name is so powerful that it reacts immediately. The example is given like poison. Knowingly or unknowingly, you take poison, poison will have its effect. You understand? So similarly, the holy name of the Lord is much, much more powerful than material poison. that it destroys all our bad, you know, thing. And not only that, it also gives us auspicious results, you know. You understand? So yeah, he also says one chanting the holy name of the Lord, it consists of two syllables, Hari. One guarantees to his path to the liberation. He guarantees his path to liberation. So you see how powerful the chanting of the Lord's name is, you know.
I can see that how powerful it is, and I can also see that somebody that is buried in their ego can't do that, can't bring themselves to even dedicate time to doing one verse versus even 108. But like, you know, so it's an ego that they're battling with to get to that point, to just utter the name. Yes. And so that makes sense. That makes a lot of sense, that how powerful just that one name is.
Haribol.
So you can see God's name, if you chant properly, then it definitely, you know, there's a lot of good reaction for you. It's not something, you know, what we say, imaginary or speculation or what. The thing is that by chanting, you get clear of all your problems, you know. And that's the unique thing about chanting God's name. Because God is so powerful, you know, and our sinful activities are compared to like darkness. Whenever there's a powerful sun in Krishna, then this material darkness is finished. You understand? So that's why the chanting of Hare Krishna is so effective, especially in the age of Kali. There's actually no other way. There's no other way, and there's no other way. You understand? So, yes, of course, the Indians have got so many mantras that they chant, but they have a big problem in the sense that they try to equate the names of all the gods and Krishna as the same. This is not correct, you know, because it says here in this verse that anyone who thinks that the name of Krishna and the name of demigods are same, then he is committing offense to chanting Krishna's name. Krishna's name and Krishna's and the demigod, they are two different personalities, you know. I am taking out the verse for you. Yes to Narayana.
You know what, when I first started chanting, I felt, they tell us, when I was raised, like I said, all these things are things I'm having to battle now, but that they taught us that, you know, that praising any God other than God is the sin. And so, but they never explain that Krishna being God and all these, you know, all these things, they make you think that Krishna is a demigod. And they make you think that he's just a nobody compared to Jesus and things like that. And so it's hard to combat that thought. So that's, I think, why that verse is in there, because of literally what I'm having to combat right now, comparing him to a demigod, and it's not accurate. And the more I release that, the more peace I get from chanting.
Yeah, because you have to be guided properly. You know, you get the wrong kind of association, then it will teach you all kind of crazy things, you know.
Yes.
Understand? So like now, you see, we are showing you evidences, you know, it says in this verse. You want to read?
You want me to? A person who considers demigods like Brahma or Shiva to be an equal level to
Narayana or Krishna, same, huh?
Okay. Is to be considered an offender or
Pashandi. Pashandi means an atheist, huh? You see how you know, you cannot equate Krishna on the same level as demigods, you know. This is a very important thing. And Krishna also says in the Bhagavad Gita, he also says the same thing. He says here, Mata Parantaram Nanyat Kinchidasti Dananjaya Mahisarvam Idam Proktam Sutre Maniganayeva. So it says here, Krishna himself is speaking, O conqueror of wealth, there is no truth superior to me. See that? There is no truth superior to me. Everything rests upon me as pearls are strung on a thread. That means Krishna doesn't have any equal or somebody above him. No. You understand? So God means he cannot have a competitor. Similarly, Krishna says here that I don't have anybody equal to me or somebody above me. So you have to understand his unique position. In fact, he says again here that he is the source of all the demigods. He says here, he who knows, sorry. He says here, neither the host of demigods nor the great sages know my origin or opulence. For in every aspect, I am the source of the demigods and sages. You understand? So Krishna's position is very unique in the sense that he is alone the supreme personality of Godhead. And if you try to bring him down to a lower level, then you're committing an offense.
Absolutely. That makes perfect sense.
So when you chant with the understanding that Krishna and the demigods are one and the same, your chanting will have no potency, no effect. Although you may chant for 300 million years, you will not have any kind of a change in your heart, you know.
Yes.
So we have to be careful. We want to do things, we must do Krishna's way. We cannot do things our Hindu way or our Chinese way or American way. No. There's only one way. It's Krishna's way.
Yeah.
That's why it says in the prayer earlier, just now, there's no other way, no other way, there's no other way.
Exactly. Say it three times. Yeah.
Yes. So if someone thinks that he knows more than God, Krishna, then better he try his luck somewhere else, you know. It's not going to work in this Krishna consciousness.
I get the feeling that that's why they did that. That it's the Christianity and Catholicism. They designed it that way so that you yourself can't get to God. That you have to go to a priest.
No. The problem is with the other so-called denomination is that they don't know exactly the name of God.
You're right.
They're very generic. You know, they call him Father. They call him Yahweh. These all are very, I would say generic terms referring to God.
Yes.
But say Krishna, specifically Krishna's name is Krishna, you know.
Yeah.
You understand? So that's the difference. If I say Father, 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 who is this Father? You also Father, I'm also Father, everybody's Father and Mother. So who am I referring to?
Correct.
Yeah, that's why when Lord Brahma was saying this prayer, he said specifically here, he says this word here. He says here, in this Bhagavad Gita verse in the Purport, Lord Brahma is saying here, it says in this prayer, Ishvaraha Paramaha Krishna Sachidananda Vigraha Anadiradir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. It says here, Ishvara means controller, you know. Ishvara means control. Everybody is controlling something. You are controlling, I'm controlling, everybody is controlling. But the supreme controller, that means of all controllers, he put this word here, is Krishna. That means of all controllers, the topmost controller is only one person, and that is Krishna. So when you say Krishna is the supreme controller, I cannot refer to Shiva or to Ganesh or to Brahma. No, it doesn't work like that. It only works to only one person. And who is that? It's Krishna.
Krishna. Krishna.
And Krishna's body is Sat. Eternal, full of knowledge and full of bliss. And he has got a form. Many people think God is formless, but here he defeats that point. It says God has got a form. Vigraha means form. You understand?
And then like here, when he came in form?
Vigraha.
Yes. Vigra means form, form. God has a form. Not that is formless. Huh? And then here he says, Anadir means he has no beginning. Definitely God has got no beginning. And here next word is Adir means he is the source of everything. And again, who is that person? Govinda. Govinda is another name of Krishna. So there's no mistake here that you cannot say God is everybody. That you cannot do that.
How many names does Krishna have? Like, is it endless?
Millions, millions of names. You cannot count.
Because how many times he's had to come and set things straight?
Govinda, Narayana, Gopala.
Krishna has got so many names that you cannot count. You know?
Yeah.
You cannot count like waves in the ocean. You cannot count how many incarnation he has taken, as many as dust, atoms. You cannot count the many atoms. Similarly, you
the
cannot
basic
count.
Ones are there in Vishnu Sahasranam, Prabhuji?
Hmm?
The basic names, at least, if she is interested, you can know in Vishnu Sahasranam.
Okay.
No, he has got millions of names. Sahasranam is something else. We have to, you know, understand this in this perspective. It says here, the Supreme Lord says, my dear friend, I have taken thousands of births, lived thousands of lives, and accepted thousands of names. In fact, my birth activities and names are limitless, and thus even I cannot count them.
I like that verse. That's good.
Understand?
Yes, yes, that makes perfect sense.
After many lifetimes, someone might count the dust particles on the earth, but no one can ever finish counting my qualities, activities, names, and birth.
Can we see the previous verse again, Prabhuji? The previous verse again.
10:51:36. So try to understand. God is, you cannot count, or you cannot, you know, there's no end. Even Lord Sesa is trying to, speak about the past time to the Lord. Up to today, he has not finished. He cannot finish.
So I'm understanding this right. Like, these are his incarnations and his names he's talking about in his life. But is he also referring
although he has so many names, but his principal name is Krishna.
Yes, yes. And so I'm saying it's like how he's talking about his qualities here and his activities, his names, and his birth. Is he referring to like being within us? And so our qualities are his qualities?
We all have got the qualities of God to minute extents. Our quality of God is limited. But God has got his qualities as deep as an ocean.
Yes.
You understand? So because we are minute particles of God, so we have got minute extent, some of his qualities. So therefore, we are small. We are called Anu, small.
Jacqueline, you liked this, right? You want to?
Yes, my dear friend, I have taken thousands of births, lived thousands of lives, and accepted thousands of names. In fact, my births, activities, names, and names are limitless, and thus even I cannot count them.
Hare Krishna.
So therefore, try to understand that Krishna, although he has got millions of names, but his topmost name is called Krishna. So we chant Hare Krishna, we are referring to God directly. That's why when you understand God in that sense, you can directly perceive him by chanting Hare Krishna. You understand this? It says in the Bhagavad Gita here, Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam Pavitram Idam Uttamam Pratyaksha Vagaham. This word here, Pratyaksha Avagamam. See, this means we can directly, you know, we can do this contact with him directly, you see. We can pratyaksha by direct experience, we can understand him. That's why when you chant, you can feel the Lord in your heart, you know. This is direct experience.
Correct.
You understand?
Correct.
So therefore, it says, and not only that, it says, su sukam, very happy you become. When you go to God, you're never sad, you know. And it's eternal. It is not something temporary, like some material happiness. It is an eternal kind of happiness. Just like if you eat sometime, then your hunger is finished and you don't want to eat anymore. But here, this chanting, you can never stop, you know. So you can read this, anyone?
This knowledge is the king of education and the most secret of all secrets. It is the purest knowledge, and because it gives direct perception of the self by realization, it is the perfection of religion. It is everlasting, and it is joyfully performed.
So try to understand. Try to understand this. The knowledge, this knowledge that we are giving, it is the king of education. There's no more higher, as we said just now, there's no more truth beyond me. But this is the topmost. There's nothing more than Krishna. And it is secret of all secrets, because hardly anyone will know this. It takes many, many lifetimes to understand this, you know. We'll come back to this, huh? We'll just go to this and come back. It says here, you know, after many, many births, huh? After many birth and death, he was actually in knowledge, surrendered to me, knowing me the cause of all causes and all that is. Such a great soul is very rare. Try to understand this knowledge, as Krishna says, is the secret of all secret and is the topmost knowledge. And to get this, it takes many, many lifetimes. You understand? It's not something that you just go and you get it, anywhere in the street or something. It's not like that, you know. That's why it says it is the purest of knowledge. It is the purest knowledge because it gives direct perception of the self. Because you're contacting directly with Krishna, so definitely it is the most pure knowledge. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
And it is the perfection of religion. You do this, you will become perfect. You know, you chant Hare Krishna, you will become perfect. That is no doubt about it.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
And it's everlasting and it's joyfully performed. You cannot be tired. You always be happy to chant. That's why we say in our, you know, one of our slogans, yeah? Chant Hare Krishna and be happy. Definitely you'll become happy. So therefore, when you chant Hare Krishna, especially, why is it more powerful? It is because another reason is that it stays here. It says here, you want to read this purport?
Ram Prabhu, can you hear? Read.
Yeah. Lord Hare Krishna, Lord Shiva voluntarily came to bless the sons of the king as well as do something beneficial for them. He personally chanted the mantra so that the mantra would be more powerful, and he advised that the mantra can be chanted by the king's sons, Rajaputras. When a mantra is chanted by a great devotee, the mantra becomes more powerful. Although the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is powerful in itself, a disciple upon initiation receives the mantra from his spiritual master. For when the mantra is chanted by the spiritual master, it becomes more powerful. Lord Shiva advised the sons of the king to hear him attentively, for inattentive hearing is offensive.
So try to understand here that when you hear this mantra, especially from Srila Prabhupada, the mantra is more powerful. Because Hare Krishna is already powerful. But when you hear it from the guru, bona fide guru, then the mantra becomes, you know, very powerful, becomes most powerful. So therefore, when the mantra is chanted like this, the disciple very quickly becomes purified, you know. Yes. And gets that taste, you know, of chanting Hare Krishna. So try to understand, these are all inner secrets of this chanting Hare Krishna. Because we just tell people very loosely, you just chant, you know, but you can see the potency. You know, the potency is that this is coming directly from Krishna through the bona fide spiritual master in a bona fide disciplic succession. You understand? So yeah. That's why Hare Krishna chanting is recommended, strongly recommended to everyone.
And knowing the importance of it, because without the intention of the...
Another thing is that even if you chant, inattentively, you know, even you chant, you know, you want to read this, please?
Sure. Mataji, can you read?
Living beings who are entangled in the complicated meshes of birth and death can be freed immediately by even unconsciously chanting the holy names of Krishna, which is feared personified.
Can become immediately free by even unconsciously chanting. You understand this unconscious chanting? Referring to somebody else or just calling, hello, Hare Krishna, hey, you know, like that.
Okay.
Not conscious about directly.
Wow, Hare Krishna.
Yes, even if you chant in that manner, you get immediately freed, he said, immediately. Yeah. So try to understand, this chanting is extremely powerful. There's nothing more powerful than this chanting. Even if you chant, like many people, they can't even pronounce properly, you know, it's a problem.
I do it when I'm not doing it with my beads, I sing it to my son. And I think of that as my non-conscious.
Yes, therefore chanting. you can read this.
Therefore, it should be understood that one is easily relieved from all sinful reactions by chanting the holy name of the Lord and chanting of his qualities and activities. This is the only process recommended for relief from sinful reactions. Even if one chants the holy name of the Lord with improper pronunciation, he will achieve relief from material bondage if he chants without offenses. Ajamila, for example, was extremely sinful, but while dying, he merely chanted the holy name, and although calling his son, he achieved complete liberation because he remembered the name of Narayana.
You see, he just called his son. He didn't even call God.
Yeah.
And he went back home to got it.
His son was the same name?
Yes. That's why the advantage. The advantage to put your son's name after Krishna, you know.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's a good idea.
Yes. And not only that, even if you chant with improper pronunciation, you know, see, also you get benefits.
That was something I wanted to ask you, and I was kind of shy about asking it because I find a lot of similarities with Christ consciousness and Krishna consciousness. A lot of similarities, and similarities that don't relate directly to the Catholic Church or anything like that, like real preen spiritual stuff that Jesus was actually trying to teach, that not like where his message got warped. And so, I think like where you're saying like the pronunciation, Christ and Krishna are two very similar sounding syllables. And so it makes me feel like Krishna consciousness and Christ consciousness, if done correctly,
God is one. God is one. You know, it's just that
that's
the method over the years, all the methods that have been there has been kind of been screwed up. You know, because over time, you know, so much of time gap, 2,000 years, so many things are changing. You know, you understand? Or they change so many things. Can you read this?
Yes, considering all these points, therefore, intelligent men decide to solve all problems by adopting the devotional service of chanting the holy name of the Lord, who is situated in everyone's hearts and who is a mine of all auspicious qualities. Such persons are not within my jurisdiction for punishment. Generally, they never commit sinful activities, but even if by mistake or because of bewilderment or illusion, they sometimes commit sinful acts. They are protected from sinful reactions because they always chant the Hare Krishna mantra.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So you can see how the chanting is so powerful.
Absolutely.
That even if you chant, you know, if you chant this mantra, that even in your dreams, you know, in your dreams, you don't see, you don't see the agents of hell.
I honestly, the hearing today when you called him the supreme controller, I felt like it was, because it controls my thoughts. When I start thinking about things I know I shouldn't think about, like the past or something, then I start chanting right away, and it totally controls my moment. It's amazing.
Yes, yes. Because God is in your heart, you know. Can you read? Someone want to read this?
Although not having fully realized the Krishna, persons who have even once surrendered completely onto his lotus feet and who have become attracted to his name, form, qualities, and pastimes are completely freed of all sinful reactions, for they have thus accepted the true method of atonement. Even in dreams, such surrendered souls do not see Yamaraj or his order carriers who are equipped with ropes to bind the sinful. Hare Krishna.
So you see here, they don't even if they are not fully realize Krishna, even in dreams, they do not see the order carriers of Yamaraj, means the servants of, you know, of hell. You know, you see how potent this chanting is. That's why when we say there's no other way, there's no other way. There is no other way. So anyone who is intelligent, he will definitely take up this process very seriously.
Correct.
Understand? That's why it is says that this chanting can be done by anybody. It can be done by anybody except the, you know, someone want to read this?
Mamta Mataji.
Hare Krishna. The holy name of Lord Krishna is an attractive feature for many saintly liberal people. It is the annihilator of all sinful reactions and is so powerful that save for the dumb who cannot chant it. It is readily available to everyone, including the lowest type of man, the chandala. The holy name of Krishna is the controller of the opulence of liberations, and it is identical with Krishna. When a person simply chants the holy name with his tongue, immediate effects are produced. Chanting the holy name does not depend on initiation, pious activities, or the purascharya regulative principles generally observed before initiation. The holy name does not wait for any of these activities. It is self-sufficient.
So you see here, everyone can chant, save for the dumb. In other words, if you don't chant, you are worse than the dumb. Yes? Yes?
Yes,
please.
So try to understand how much simple it is made for Kali Yuga. There's no other way, so much more easier than just to chant Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And just by doing this, a person gets all success, you know. That's why people who are very intelligent, they wait for this Kali Yuga to come. Because this in this Kali Yuga, very easily you can just chant and go home back to God, you know.
Those who are actually advanced in knowledge are able to appreciate the essential value of this age of Kali. Such enlightened persons worship Kali Yuga because in this fallen age, all perfection of life can easily be achieved by the performance of Sankirtana.
Sankirtana means congregational chanting.
Yes, Prabhu.
Read on.
Indeed, there is no higher possible gain for embodied souls forced to wander throughout the material world than the Supreme Lord Sankirtana movement, by which one can attain the supreme peace and free oneself from the cycle of repeated birth and death.
So you see how beneficial. Not only that, you know, Shri says here by Yamaraj that anyone who chants, then they told his servants not to go to them. He says, one reads.
Hare Krishna. My dear servants, please do not approach such devotees, for they have fully surrendered to the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They are equal to everyone, and their narrations are sung by the demigods and the inhabitants of Siddhaloka. Please do not even go near them. They are always protected by the club of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And therefore, Lord Brahma and I, and even the time factor, are not competent to chastise them.
So this is being told by Yamaraja to his servants.
Oh.
Read on, please.
Yeah. Paramahamsas are exalted persons who have no taste for material enjoyment and who drink the honey of the Lord's lotus feet. My dear servants, bring to me for punishment only persons who are averse to the taste of that honey, who do not associate with Paramahamsas, and who are attached to family life and worldly enjoyment, which form the path to hell. My dear servants, please bring to me only those sinful persons who do not use their tongues to chant the holy name and qualities of Krishna, whose hearts do not remember the lotus feet of Krishna even once, and whose heads do not bow down even once before Lord Krishna. Send me those who do not perform their duties towards Vishnu, which are the only duties in human life. Please bring me all such fools and rascals.
You see how the other side of the coin. If you chant, you get all maximum protection, benefits and everything. But if you don't do so, then the consequence is going to be very drastic. Yes?
Yes.
It is not my saying here. This is spoken by Yamaraj himself, who is the god in charge of, demigod in charge of the hellish worlds, particularly meting out punishments to conditioned souls. So these are all warnings. You know, if you don't want to take care, then it's going to be trouble. You can say, oh, who cares, you know, who knows, you know, these are all some things, you know. You can take the risk. Nobody's saying no, correct?
Take another life.
Yeah,
that's what it costs you. You have to learn it all over. Try it. Do it again. Wake up all over again.
Yeah. If you want to be a fool, you want to put your hand in fire and get it burned, then you're foolish.
and risk being born in some other country that you're not going to have the freedom to do.
And you will not even, you may not even get a human life. You'll have to go through the 8.4 million species.
You're right. You're right.
If you go to hell, you come back, you're not going to get human birth straight away. You got to go to the lower species of life and start climbing up, you know. And that is going to be extreme pain. So think, there is a universal management as in the hands of God. And if you try to transgress their rules, just like material laws are there to punish those who are delinquent, similarly, there are laws, you know, by God to take care of people who are transgressing his scriptural codes. So we have to be careful. That's why it is very simple. Just to chant Hare Krishna, it's got no cost. It's got, you know, anybody can do it. The tongue is there, the mouth is there, you know, and the ears are there. And all you have to do is repeat humbly and sincerely. And Krishna says, I'll give you all protection, I'll give you all help, I give you everything. So why not take advantage of it? At least, why not make an experiment and try and see whether it works?
That's what I did.
You should now go out and tell everybody to chant.
Yeah, I thought about making a shirt of what you said. I forgot what you said earlier. I'm gonna have to watch this back. You said chant Hare Krishna and be happy.
Yes.
I thought somebody should need. I want to see that on a T-shirt.
Guys, I want to take it from distribution.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
All the devotees should wear like that. Yeah.
Absolutely.
We have a book called Chant and Be Happy. We can probably distribute that book, you know.
Absolutely.
Hmm.
I've actually had a heart for positive shirts, and like looking at buying shirts with positive messages has always been my thing. And then I thought, why not make a company that does that? And I've just been always putting down on notepads, like positive messages that I would put on a t-shirt, and that just stuck in my head. And so I wonder if maybe that's what Krishna wants me to do with that kind of a heart for that.
Yes.
I think I might just do that. I'll get a nice please, box for you guys.
Please try to help. Please try to help a lot of your fellow Americans, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, that's why I liked that idea, because it was a way of spreading message without talking and intruding. And it would be almost not like a lure, but like an open doorway for conversation. Like, oh, hey, I love your shirt. Wow. Yeah, actually, this is really important. That's why I made it.
Correct.
So,
like what she told, is any t-shirt like that available for purchase at ISKCON Los Angeles?
I think so. They are. You can go online and buy them.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a krishnastore.com. You can get it there.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
All right. So any other questions or anything?
Prabhu, there is one more verse in Bhagavatam, right, where what kind of people worship Ganesha, Durga, Lord Shiva, different kinds of people.
Bhagavad Gita, it is say, if you worship demigods, you go to the demigod world. You don't go to Krishna.
And aren't the demigods for material things?
What?
Don't the demigods provide material things?
Yeah,
they can only provide material things. They cannot take you to the spiritual world. See here, someone can.
So they're just entangling you. Those who worship the demigods will take birth among the demigods. Those who worship the ancestors go to the ancestors. Those who worship ghosts and spirits will take birth among such beings. And those who worship me will live with me.
So here you can see here, if you worship the demigods, you go to their place. But you worship Krishna, you go to Krishna's place. Two different places, you know.
Yeah.
Not that everything ends up in the same place.
Yeah.
You understand? So that's for demigod worship is actually not recommended at all. Just prior to this verse, you can see Krishna is saying here. You can read this.
Those who are devotees of other gods and who worship them with faith actually worship only me, O son of Kunti, but they do so in a wrong way.
So that's why I see demigod worship is not recommended by God himself. You understand? So demigod worship and Krishna worship are two different. You know, again, I think there's a video that I put up, you know, yes?
Yeah.
Says here.
It is said that one result is obtained by worshiping the supreme cause of all causes, and that another result is obtained by worshiping what is not supreme. All that is heard from the undisturbed authorities who clearly explain it.
So from here you can see you worship the demigod, you go to the demigod thing, but you worship Krishna, you go to the supreme spiritual world where you never return again. Because demigod worship, even you go to the topmost demigod planet, that is Lord Brahma's, you still have to come back again. You see, it says here, from the highest planet in the material world, that means Lord Brahma's planet, and all down to the lowest are all places of miseries wherein repeated birth and death takes place. But for one who attends my abode, O son of Kunti, never takes birth again. See that? There's a clear line, you know. Not all things, as they always say, these people, all rivers lead to the ocean. No, this is nonsense. We don't believe that. We don't accept that also, you know. You understand?
I understand.
So when we speak something, we must back it up with scripture, you know. We can't just kind of speculate, you know, my father said and my grandmother said, this is how we have learned, this is how my whole family has been doing. This is not like that, you know. You have to learn from God himself. You cannot just learn something with, you know, some family kind of thing. And that's what Hinduism all about, you know. They just speculate everything. Everybody thinks they know better. They know better than God, you know. That's all they think. But here, God is speaking, and they don't want to give him a chance to speak, you know.
Yeah, that is Kali Yuga.
One should know perfectly that the personality of Godhead is Krishna, and his transcendental name, form, qualities, and pastime, as well as the temporary material creation with the temporary demigods, men, and animals. When one knows this, he surpasses death and the ephemeral cosmic manifestation with it. And in the eternal kingdom of God, he enjoys eternal life full of bliss and knowledge. You see here, the name of God is different from this temporary material creation with this temporary demigods, man and animals. So God is permanent, Krishna, whereas all the others are impermanent. And they cannot save you. No demigods can save you. That's also explained here. Lord Shiva says, no demigods can save anyone. Demigods can save anyone, even Lord Shiva is saying. Says here. Lord Shiva says, Mukti Pradata Sarvesham Vishnu Evana Samsayaha. There's no doubt that Vishnu is the deliverer of liberation for everyone. only Krishna can deliver you. That's why his other name is called Mukunda. Mukunda means one who gives you liberation. Nobody else can give you liberation. No demigods can do that. So this is intelligence to know and do the right thing. Understand, sentiment doesn't work, you know. We have to have sound philosophy. Then our faith will solidify. If I know what to do, then I do it right. If I don't know what to do and I do, I'll mess it up.
Yeah.
Simple as that. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
In fact, the demigods are even more pleased when you do direct devotional service to Krishna.
God himself is saying that, you know, if you want to get out of this material world, you have to go to, they say that we can give you anything except liberation. You know, they themselves are saying they can give anything except liberation. So you can see from this statement how they themselves are conditioned and they themselves cannot save you. Huh? Understand this. Yes. Demigods are speaking here. What happened to this? What's going on here? So here, demigods are speaking. Demigods are saying this. Oh, all good fortune to you. Now please choose a benediction from us. Anything but, you see, anything but. What is that but? Since only the infallible Supreme Lord Vishnu can bestow that. So if you want to stay here and rot here, that is your choice. But if you want to get out, then there's only one person. Only one person can help you. Either it's Vishnu or Krishna, the same. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Hare Krishna.
In fact, after each Mahayuga, even Lord Brahma is annihilated. So he can't give liberation to other living entities.
No, he cannot. When Hiranyakashipu approached him and said, please benedict me with immortality, he said, I myself will die. How can I give you immortality? So try to understand the difference between Krishna and all the other demigods. It's not the same.
Yes.
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 All right. Any other questions?
Thank you so much, Prabhu, for all the clarification. And
very nice. Thank you.
Shastric references.
Thank you. Thank you.
Slowly attending the sessions, more doubts are clearing up. Very nice.
What?
Thank you. All doubts are clearing. Thank you.
This is what it means when you associate with the right kind of devotees. You will get faith, you know. Your faith will get strengthened.
Stronger, yeah. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
You know, if you don't get the right kind of association, then you will always be in doubts, you know.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes.